Okay, so, hey, excellent. We are going to head into a couple lightning talks now to wrap up this morning slot, which is going to be very exciting. These intrepid speakers are going to try and go fast and come up with, you don't have to go super fast, but get through some exciting ideas. So our first lightning speaker is Linas Gabrielaitis, who is a PhD, starting a PhD at the intersection of game studies and literature, exploring geological perspectives within game mechanics, which is very interesting. So I just want to give you time to get right into your talk, Linas.
Okay, hello, thank you. Hopefully everything's okay with my microphone. So my name is Linas. I'm doing a PhD at the gamification group in Tampere University in Finland. And so the title of my talk is Fictions of Infinity in Geological Finitudes, which is a pretty complicated title. So pretty much the whole talk, I'm gonna be explaining what I mean by the title and what the concepts are implied in it. And so hopefully I can inspire some new maybe ideas, maybe in some new game mechanics. So first of all, what I mean by fictions of infinity. So of course, I'm referring to roguelikes. They're also known as infinite death labyrinths or procedural death labyrinths. They make use of procedurality for emergent content, of course, and also death is an inevitable and central part of the experience. And so I see a lot of similarities, and that's what I'm going to be doing in the presentation, going back and forth between roguelikes and geology. And so geological layers are also kind of working with a certain procedural logic. And also death is also central in geology. Some layers are actually made up of dead or previously alive matter. So, for example, this layer called sedimentary rock is made up of skeletons and shells that have been squeezed and then formed into a rock. And so besides death, I will also be talking about a lot about depth, which is also present in roguelikes, as I hope to show. And so let's get into the deaths and the depths. So this is a diagram of how a roguelike game might look like. We have a town where you do your upgrades, your shopping, and then you dive deep into the dungeon, where with each layer, you kind of get progressively more complicated. This diagram is actually from the Diablo pitch done by Condor in 1994, where they first proposed how a Diablo game could look like in the roguelike format. Something is, of course, interesting is that they were talking already about death and how to kind of position death in roguelikeness. So I'm just going to read out the sentence. So if one of those arrows ends up killing the fighter, the character will be erased completely from the hard drive and the player must start from scratch. And then besides death, something that I've been kind of picking apart is the deepness metaphor or the depth metaphors. So I'm going to read out the highlighted sentence. So deeper levels will contain progressively more difficult creatures and hazards. A character's quest ends with the defeat of Diablo, located deep in the dungeon. So now I've kind of annotated the diagram with a depth, which kind of brings you back, and then a depth, which with which you progressively dive deeper. Of course, this is how a dungeon might look like. After you complete it, you then dive deeper. And so here I'm going to get into the start of geology, or I guess what we now call geology. So Nicola Steino in 1668, he invented depth. He was the first geologist, although I'm not sure if he called himself a geologist, but then he was basically digging around and then he noticed that, the deeper you go, the older everything gets. So that was a kind of a first spatialization of time, or maybe a vertical diagramming of time. And then that also kind of kicked off a whole other branch of, I guess, deep sciences or deep sciences of depth. So for example, before psychology became psychology, there was depth psychology, which had the same kind of deepness metaphors that we use now. So for example, the deeper you go into someone, the more traumatic or more traumatizing everything is. Also interpersonal relationships, the longer you spend with someone, the deeper you go into them. So this kind of depth is, well, time related. And of course, dwarves and dwarf fortress are great, kind of deep scientists of the depth. They use mines. Mines are kind of very vertically constructed. And so something similar to mines, oil wells are also very vertical structures. And so it's interesting that oil has also a natural tendency to move upwards. So it seeps through layers that have tiny holes, but then gets trapped by this kind of layer of rock, which it cannot pass. And so it's, I guess, here I'm seeing some sort of rogue-likeness in the way that oil is working, in the sense that it always tries to go up. And so it is also rogue-likeness a little bit, because oil is something that has, it used to be organic, it used to be alive, but now it's kind of undead. It's organic matter, which is kind of, was not allowed to die or fossilize properly. And so it was kind of a trapped bundle of energy, which we are now helping kind of bring vertically up. Another vertical science is the study of holes. And this book kind of has no offer and no dates. It's just a collection of holes. Don DeLillo also wrote about holes. So here, there's a sentence, holes are interesting. There are books about holes. But now I'm gonna dive deeper into another story by Don DeLillo. It's called Ratner Star. And there they explore, or they dig this great hole, which is kind of described as it's a descent to a geological drive, or maybe a geological fetish, kind of this need to go deeper. But then at certain depth, they discover that ancient artifacts actually begin to grow more complex, which is, it's interesting because, well, real geology works the opposite way. Things actually get more primitive the deeper you go. And so here's some diagrams or some quotes to illustrate this. So human, more advanced the deeper we dig. We could say that the larvae are tastier the deeper I dig. The deeper we went, the greater the complexity of the tool types, of the culture in general. And so here, I'm reminded of the way that progression works in roguelikes. Of course, the deeper you go, the more complex everything is, the more you progress. Now going back to the story. So it ends, the story ends with an event where they find out they've been receiving these messages, which they thought comes from space, but then later they find out that it comes actually from deep time, from below. And so here there's another also inversion of space. So at the time, it was the space race where everyone was kind of obsessed with the verticality, upwards verticality of the space. But then DeLillo was writing about these kind of downwards verticalities. And so I've been using this deep space, deep time comparison, or maybe friction between these two concepts. I think it's a bad example to do this comparison, but I think it also illustrates something that the way that Starbound, for example, was using procedurality to also kind of promise an infinite amount of stars or infinite amount of planets to visit, to explore, while Terraria had a very kind of constrained. You knew that there was an ocean on the left, on the right, there's lava at the end, at the bottom. Of course, No Man's Sky had this kind of rode on the promise of procedural generation to generate the deep infinity. I think someone calculated that you need 600,000 years, real life years, to explore all the planets. So of course, nobody has time for that. And this reminds me of another story by this time by Jorge Borges Lewis. So he wrote about the Library of Babel. It's called, well, a library that has every conceivable book that can ever be written. So not only books that have been written, but then that can be possibly written. So it's an infinitely deep library. So I'm going to read out the quote. The universe, which others call the library, is composed of an indefinite and perhaps infinite number of hexagonal galleries with vast air shafts between, surrounded by very low railings. And then they also talk about the uniqueness of each book. So will the book be unique? So here's a sentence. Each book is unique and irreplaceable, but since the library is total, there are always several hundred thousand almost identical books that differ by no more than a single letter or a comma. And then kind of the story goes that actually the characters are lost in this vast infinity. They continuously talk about this lack of meaning. And then in the end, there's also people jumping down these railings. So now that I'm getting to this kind of, okay, deep space promises some sort of infinite procedurality and infinity of books, stars, planets, with a question mark, what is then the deep time of procedurality? And here I'm kind of, well, provoking in some way. I'm trying to look for these deep procedurality. And so I'm going to draw from, I guess, the science of how mountains are moving. And in some way, they're not moving, but then they're moving in place. So if they're not moving, they're actually like moving in on themselves or moving, turning over themselves. And so that's a mechanism of folding. And so basically my provocation here is, I guess I'm trying to propose folding as a mechanism of how maybe a deep procedurality could look like. But then it is proposing with a question mark, could even procedural layers look like that? Also because of folding, you have these mountains that kind of get cut off in the middle. So yeah, folding for roguelikes or for deep roguelikes. And yeah, so thank you very much. And thank you for organizing. And hopefully you enjoyed.
Thank you. Oh, that was great. Yeah, people really enjoyed it. You had a lot of very like quotable, like, what do you mean oil goes up? What do you mean? Like, we have to think about the concept of depth. I think that's really interesting. And I love to see, you know, we talk a lot about map generation, but I have never seen the idea of map generation taking inspiration from like layers and thinking about those layers in a geological and like a time related sense. So yeah, that's really interesting. We might have time for like one question if anyone wants to get one up there. Ooh, we do. Which is kind of a comment, but I think it's interesting, yeah. Which is that there is a sense in which NetHack's bones levels are kind of a proto-folding, since you get previous experiences kind of folded into future games. I know that like bones is another concept that you considered getting into, but...
Yeah, I'd like to see a diagram of how that folding works in NetHack. I think because most of this kind of works on a very diagrammatic level, and also sketching is, I guess, an important part in making games. I'd like to see a drawing.
And I think that as far as I know, NetHack, there isn't necessarily a lot of thought put into like where in the layers it should fit, which is I think like the extra piece here of. What we could gain by putting more thought into that. So cool. Well, thank you. I think that I'll let you go since I want to make sure that we get to the next lightning talk.